happy to see you again, and happy to see that everybody is safe, everybody is doing well, and the factories are running fine. We are working at 50% capacity. I would say we are very, very fortunate that so many people decided to come for work. So already 2,500 people are working in all the 7 plants in India, and we are running at around 50% capacity already now. We have almost 500 staff members working in all the plants. So everybody has decided to come and work in this time and help the humanity. So I salute everybody who is coming and working with Polymed and who is working from home, whether working in the plants. So yeah, you all deserve a big salute from all of us, and thank you very much for being there. And now to take this forward, I would like to introduce Dr. Sanjeev. So I was introduced to Dr. Sanjeev by Dr. Vikram a few months ago, and incidentally, we have all gone to the same school. Dr. Sanjeev brother Rajiv also studied with me in class, my class. So, that's the connect we could establish very quickly. He was very kind to show us the new hospital he's constructing, which is a 2,250-bed hospital coming in Greater Faridabad area, which was the largest hospital in the country in the private sector, which is coming up, and it's built in around 110 acres of space, and with great facilities, with a nursing school, with a medical college, with different lab facilities. And I'll let Dr. Sanjeev talk more about it, but it really excited me because with the kind of research facilities they are going to build in, this will be a great advantage for Polymed in times to come to partner with Amrita Institute in Faridabad and also in different places to develop, design, and test new devices together and work with clinicians and engineers working together. That will be a big advantage for our company. And I'm thankful to Dr. Sanjeev, for accepting, this kind of proposal. And he was very, coming forward and telling us that, they will be willing to, this kind of activities. And just to give a background of Dr. Sanjeev, so Dr. Sanjeev has been working with the Amrita Group, for a very long time. And I think it's more than 10 years, Dr. Sanjeev, if I'm correct.
17,
sorry, sir. Pardon me, sir. Sorry, sir. And he also chairs the research committee at NABH. For anything for quality and NABH, he's the authority today in the country. And of course, he's got great credentials, vast experience in managing hospital operations. Just imagine, single-handedly is building a hospital for 2,250 beds, which will be the largest private sector hospital in the country. So that is the kind of, today, skill he has got, the kind of, experience he has got, the kind of authority he has got. So he's playing a very, very important role, in improving the quality of patient care and, managing, such a great facility, big facility. He's written a lot of journals. He's been on a lot of international, symposium, conferences. He's, the most sought after person, we are talking of quality of patient care. And he's got a lot of affiliations, also international affiliation. So we are honored, for Dr. Sanjeev, agreeing to spend some time with our team. And, I am over to you, Dr. Sanjeev.
Right. Thank you, Himanshu. It was such a great pleasure meeting you a couple of months back. And that was very nostalgic. Meeting anybody from the school is a phenomenal feeling. But what was significant is that in our old boys association, I think you are most respected because you have done so very well and so very well respected. Establishing a $100 million industry with so much of huge potential and 9 plants and exporting most of the devices which you make is just phenomenal. So may God give you more strength and more courage to do good work for the country. And you have done phenomenally. We're very, very proud of you. As Zevrite, we're very, very proud of you.
Thank you, sir. It's all because of you people, sir. It's all because of you people.
So thank you, Dr. Vikram, for are my slides visible?
Yes, sir. They are visible, sir.
Perfect. So thank you, Dr. Vikram. I think he has been a catalyst to unite a lot of people. And he has been one of those role models and the leaders in the country who has groomed, mentored, run fantastic hospitals, established huge management principles, and I'm so grateful to him. He is my mentor too, and he has done so phenomenally well. And thank you for uniting us with Himanshu.
Pleasure, honor.
Dr. Vikram asked me to speak on need for quality standards, and I think it is very much relevant within the present context, and even for COVID. How do we work on COVID? Because there are few standards which have been laid down by Ministry of Health and CDC and ICMR, and that's how those standards are adhered, and then guidelines are made, and then the implementation happens. So what I'm going to speak is for the next 15 to 20 minutes is, there are lots of international national bodies who have made standards. There are a few case studies to make this point very relevant. And I must congratulate Himanshu. I am so impressed that you have a very disciplined group. You said 100 people will join in, and 100 people did join in. And if I call a meeting in my hospital, it would be so difficult.
100 people are waiting, sir, right now. My brother cannot join. Rishi cannot join because already 100 limit has crossed.
Amazing, amazing. It is so difficult to get people together in the hospital to have participate in a meeting. But it's good that you have a very disciplined group. So this is what I'm going to cover. And we all know that it is extremely chaotic right now. It is chaotic because the whole healthcare is complex. The Harvard Business Review says that one patient who gets admitted in a tertiary care setup has minimum, if his length of stay is 3 to 4 days, has minimum of 32 touch points. So there is the resident doctors, the professors and associate professors who meet this, the nursing staff, the respiratory therapists, the technicians, the imaging technicians, the lab, the phlebotomist. So there are, it is a complex environment. And then nowadays we know that government is controlling, there is huge attrition. Skill sets is good and bad because there is huge depletion with respect to allied health sciences. Hospitals are primarily urban based, and the basic structure is missing. So it is chaotic, and what we would like to see is a very, very smooth ride. But what is also important is the Harvard Business Review also brought in the fact that we need to focus on outcomes, because ultimately, if you're running a business, you need to know what your top line is and what your EBITDA is. And if I'm running a hospital, I need to know whether my patients are surviving and are they doing good. So how do we get into a good outcome hospital? And that is where the standards play a very, very critical role. So there is a body which is called as ISQA, International Society for Quality. So that is the topmost body which is situated in Dublin. So all bodies who accredite or are quality standards body has to have this membership with ISQA. And ISQA lays down the standards for various other national, international bodies to adhere to those standards. And ISO is a fantastic process-oriented group which certifies. And then there is a Joint Commission International or Joint Commission Accreditation for Healthcare Organization in US. Canada, Accreditation Canada is a fantastic accreditation body, does huge research. There is almost every country has an accreditation body. And India is not left behind. In 2003, there was a few tourists who had come and had fallen ill. And when they got admitted into the hospital, those tourists were asking, are they following standards? And this question was raised in a parliament, and the parliament, when the question was answered, they realized that India doesn't have a quality standards. And that is where the group of people got united, and Quality Council of India was given this mandate. And then 2005, National Accreditation Board for Hospital Healthcare Providers was established. So this is NABH is the country's quality standard body, which just 2 months back have released the latest guideline, that is the fifth edition. But then they have various guidelines. They have guidelines for small hospitals, for dental, for medical, for imaging, for Ayush, for spa, for blood storage, blood banks, and various accreditation standards have been laid down, and which makes things very useful. So how do we need to behave? So basically, I would not like to take an airline example, which is often taken. And if you visit a wildlife sanctuary and you realize that there is an instinctive behavior with which we need to perform in healthcare. And why do I say that? You need to be always on a watch out. Watch out for guidelines, watch out for how you're doing, both in business and patient safety, quality. You need to have that kind of a sense. And that is where this wildlife, this king of jungles or cheetah, they have this sense to understand, to have the sensitivity to understand what the patient wants, what the healthcare, what the doctors want, what the healthcare workers want. But primarily, there needs to be an instinct of protection. So they need to protect first the patient, because it is the patient who is the king and the prime member for which the hospital is running. And they also need to protect the business as well as the healthcare workers who deliver the care. They also need to report. So if there is any movement in the jungle, it gets immediately reported and they're all alerted. So that reporting is key, because that is how you generate data and you become a very evidence-based or data-driven decision-making rather than an ad hoc. You need to guide, because the bigger animals, the bunch of family which is there in the wildlife, they do guide people. And that is what happens, because there is a skill sets which are there, there's a competency which is available. And then you mentor various people, both in clinical and non-clinical and allied sciences. And you continuously learn, because you realize that now the prey is not there in this part of the jungle and you need to move. So you continuously keep learning. And that's the behavior which even the healthcare provider needs to have. And you share, because if the preys are depleted, you share. If there is only one zebra who has been killed, and then you share with others, because the life cycle within the wildlife needs to go on. And that is what is key even for the hospitals and healthcare provider. But what is foremost is this team behavior. What happens in the wildlife, this team medicine is the key. And that is where the individual practice oriented mom and pop shop, which was there earlier, has been migrated into a team medicine practice, which the Mayo Clinic has established. So let me give some case studies. So you would know about this incident which happened in one of the districts in the country. And there was a massive fire. So at 2 a.m., there was a smoke at the basement. At 2:15, there was a fire at the basement. 3:30, the fire got it started spreading. 3:45, the staff got alerted. 4 extinguishers were operated. 4:15, fire brigade was called. 4:30, they realized that there is a double barrier glass and they cannot break those glass, and there is huge toxic fumes which are coming. 4:45 a.m., rescue process got started. And you realize 2 a.m. to 4:45 a.m. And that's the timeline which difference. 7:30 a.m., firemen broke the wall of the basement and they were able to get in to understand where it is all generating from. And they started flooding at 7:40. So 2 a.m. to 7:40. And that's the key. 7:45, they could enter. 8, snorkel arrived. 11:45, fire was under control. So 2 a.m. to 11:45 and 5 p.m. rescue operation took place. So what happened? What was the outcome? 86 patients died and 3 paramedics died because of this fire incident. So can we learn something from this particular incident? And if you do a root cause analysis, you realize that the basement, which should be free, was full of inflammable and hazardous chemicals. The fire extinguishers, which was there, but which was there as cosmetics, it did not work. The preventive maintenance was not done. Alarm did not activate because there were false alarms and it was always beeping. So they switched off all the alarms. No evacuation was initiated for 1.5 years. While the smoke was there, while the fire was there, electrical and the central AC was not stopped. Carbon monoxide gas started spreading. There was no mock drill because every healthcare provider had no clue what to do. and the escape routes, which is so very well required around in accordance to NBC 2005 and 2015 guidelines, escape routes were all blocked. So what do we learn? And the setback around the hospital, the fire extinguisher could not come in because it was all parked in, and it was so difficult. So what do we learn in? So there needs to be standards, and there needs to be standard which guide us to give that kind of a facility safety. So there could be patient safety, there could be healthcare worker safety, but facility safety is also very key. And that is why the standards are laid down for us to adhere and such incidents don't happen. So there are various chapters. Fire installation should be as per NBC, and that is laid down. So every hospital needs to adhere that. Safety committee should do facility rounds. There is a provision for detection, abatement, containment of fire emergency, and you need to check this periodically. So it is all laid down. These are standards which are laid down, and that is where it helps us to keep our facility safe and maintain it at proper, and staff needs to be oriented and mock drill needs to be conducted. And this needs to be conducted periodically at every facility and at periodic time. Now let's look at another. I don't know whether you remember Sri Devi and her mother getting operated. So her mother got operated. She went to Sloan Kettering Hospital, one of the best hospitals in the world. And she met the neuro-oncologist, Dr. Thomas Jefferson, one of the best neuro-oncologists in the world. And then she was operated on the right side of the brain. And they soon realized that there is no tumor. And then they have started getting, when the MRI images was brought in into the OR, they realized it is all there in the left brain. And then they operated on the left brain. So what I'm trying to say, best of the hospital, best of the doctors, best of the facility, things can go wrong. And that is where we need to continuously work on those standards. So in one of those hospitals in Delhi, there was this 24-year-old who had a fall and came up with a fracture of right, but unfortunately was operated on left. And then he got shifted to another hospital. He was very angry. There was an expert committee, and then doctors were penalized and they were suspended. So what was the outcome? 1 month of recovery for poor 24-year-old. There is extra payments, and then there is mental harassment. So there is a person called Atul Gawande who has done phenomenally well. He is one of those stalwart leaders. And he has come up with this surgical safety checklist. So before you induce a patient, you need to check. Before giving a skin incision, you need to check. Before leaving an operating room, you need to check. And he published that in NEJM in September 2009. And he has shown that the morbidity, mortalities, and infection rates comes down if the adherence is there. So what did not happen in this case, which was admitted in Delhi, a 24-year-old who had fallen? The standards was not practiced. It is all written down. So pre-operative assessment and documentation needs to be there. There needs to be an identification tag. So a marking of what needs to be operated, which site, has to be there. It is all written down. It is surgical safety and cross-checking. Surgical timeout should be adhered to, and patient safety program should be continuous. So these standards guides us so that these incidents don't happen. And that is where quality standards are extremely important. Now look at this example of 2017 at Bellary. Now 15 women were admitted for tubectomy. An ASHA worker gave a medication which was a wrong medication. And the patient started having vomiting, hypertension, and unconsciousness. And they were sent to a taluk hospital for recovery. Again, what was the outcome? Longer stay of all these 15 patients, mental harassment, and then one worker was suspended. So wrong medications do happen in the hospital. So how do we avoid all this? Because there are look-alike and sound-alike medications. There are high-risk medications. There are, before giving a medication, you need to watch. And then there are 6 hours and 7 hours every time you give a medication to a patient. Is the patient right? Is the drug right? Is the route right? Is the frequency right? You need to check. And that is what standards have laid down. And that is what would help so that such incidents don't happen. Now, this was in one of those premier hospitals of the country in Mumbai. I'm not naming any of the hospital because that would not be fair. In 2014, the doctor at 5 p.m. ordered an MRI. 6:30 p.m. he was shifted to get an MRI done. 7 p.m. the doctor asked for an oxygen, and 7:05 the ward boy brought in an oxygen cylinder. Oxygen cylinder has a body which has iron, and he had no clue of the safety measure. So MRI machine is very high magnetic field. It has 1.5 tesla, and immediately two of the staff were sucked into this machine, and one machine got damaged. Second, the risk of these two staff were there. So these incidents do happen. So are there any standards which can avoid this? So there are quality standards saying appropriately screen for safety in imaging. Imaging personnel should be trained in radiation safety, and radiation safety, one of those measures is definitely mentioning about the high magnetic field of MRI, and nothing which attracts. Even your credit cards are not allowed. Signages needs to be prominently displayed, and if that would have been displayed, and if people would have been trained, it would have been, those incidents could definitely be avoided. Now, whenever a mass casualty comes in and the patient is there, this is what now, even in COVID, they're following the same mechanism. So if you need to prioritize, you need, and that is how in COVID also they are creating a red zone, the yellow zone, and the green zone. And that is how when in ER, if you have seen a movie called Pearl Harbor, and when there was a blast, that nurse or that lady used her lipstick to identify and prioritize patients, because you cannot be giving treatment to everybody. So you do prioritize, and who tells us? The quality standards tells us that this is how you need to treat patients. Now, there are lots of good standards which have also been laid down for patient safety. If there is anything as a laboratory result, if your hemoglobin has come as 6, creatinine has come as 2, potassium has come as 7.5, these are high alert, and you cannot be waiting for the next day the doctor and the resident doctors to come to treat. So these are critical lab results. You need to inform immediately in the interest of patient safety. If your pulmonary vein flow is not good enough, if you have a dissecting aneurysm in an MRI, you need to immediately inform. But these results also need to have a turnaround time. You cannot keep waiting that, yes, MRI has been done, tomorrow the results would be given. So there has to be a turnaround time. There is also importance of early warning sign. You cannot just wait for the patient to collapse and be pulseless and BP-less. You need to identify those triggers to be able to understand, yes, those patients would be handled and they need not get into a CPR mode. How do you do this? You also do lots of audits. You do prescription audits. You do even for clinical work. And that is why I have added clinical audit is with quality standards adherence, there is a lot of good work, cosmetic work, which is being done. But what would be most beneficial if we get into a clinical excellence and clinical audit work and perform appropriately in with respect to international benchmark. Now, COVID, that's why I added this hospital infection prevention. You need to put a structure, you need to put a process, and you need to put an outcome in place. So what do you need to do? You need to have a program, a committee, a team, officer, nurse, surveillance, risk rates entrance. And then there is some processes which you need to do, like hand hygiene, standard precaution, surveillance, safe injection, and even for polymed, vascular management, safe injection, safe infusion practices are so very relevant. So these all practices need to be adhered in all hospitals. So I'll give you an example of my hospital. So it is important to have data. It is important to analyze data. And all, if you adhere to quality, the cost should come down. So here is where we do basic training for the healthcare workers and the faculty. We look at hand hygiene, we look at our isolation practices, we look at our wound care management. We also look at outcomes, whether adhering to all the processes improves outcome with respect to readmission rates, surgical site infection, catheter, ventilator associated pneumonia, or urinary tract infection. And when you do basic training, all these infections rates have come down. But what I want to bring it to your notice is, with every good adherence and timely adherence of quality standards, it would definitely be cost effective and cost benefit. And that is where we have published this information. We spent 700 rupees in training. So our investment was close to $1 and our return of investment was close to $236. So in just one department of cardiovascular thoracic for 1 year, our savings was close to 2 crores. So what I'm trying to drill down is that every bit of process done well and adherence to quality brings in a good outcome, including cost. Now let's look at another process or a quality initiative. This is rational antibiotic prescription. Now antibiotics have always been understood as a wonder drug. So it's a Ramban, just like steroids you give and you wait for a good result. So everything what is written in blue is a structure. We put in a structure in place. Everything what is written in green is a process. And we put in a good process. And this is close to 3 years of good data. And we have published this in Infectious Disease Journal of America. And all in red, we continuously monitor outcomes. So is the compliance good enough? Is the mortality good enough? And then we measure the outcomes. So compliance has increased to 73%. Mortality has been reduced. The length of stay has been reduced. So if you see, if our revenue per operating bed is close to 25,000, if we are getting this, 1 day of length of stay being available to us, it would be phenomenal. And here also, just following a good, rational, appropriate antibiotic prescription, the saving was close to 2.2 crores. And that's where I would like to drill that point. But it needs to be continuous in nature. There are lots and lots of quality improvement tool which needs to be put in practice. So there are run charts, there are control charts, there are Pareto, there are design of experiments, there are value stream mapping, Lean, Six Sigma. Everything, whatever is done in manufacturing, automobiles, can be done in healthcare, and we have published 5 Lean Six Sigma implementation in the hospital. So it is definitely possible, but adhering to those is important. I would like to bring this a phenomenal work which we have done with the Imperial College and University of Cape Town, and this has been funded by Economic Social Council of UK. So just working on process and outcomes, we have realized, doesn't work at all. Now we think that it needs to be and training also doesn't work. You need to change the behavior of the doctor and change the behavior of the healthcare worker. So this is in one of the wards, in the cardiovascular thoracic ward. We follow every doctor, and if you realize, he is the HOD, and then he maximally speaks with the surgical resident, and that is the communication which is happening. Or he speaks to the nurse who has come for the morning round. He's trying to find out what happens last night with the patient. He occasionally speaks to the caregiver, but he rarely speaks to the patient. And he tells to the patient, sab theek ho jayega, aap chinta mat karo, aapki dawa badal di hai. And then there are these resident doctors, associate professor, assistant professor, they are all there as mute spectators. And their contribution towards, why? Because in India, it is very hierarchical in approach. The team medicine is still not practiced. Now, let's go to another department. This is in GI surgery. So there is, again, the phenomena remains the same. There is a senior surgeon who speaks, and who speaks to the nurse in charge, who speaks to the surgical. Rest of them are absolutely mute spectator. But most of the time, they're speaking to the carer. And that is where I'm trying to drill another point. This is a very Western concept that we should build a patient-centric hospital. I'm trying to say we should build a carer-centric and patient-centric hospital, because in India, carer plays a huge role in patients' recovery or patients' treatment. And that is what we are seeing. And we share all these sociograms with our doctors, and they also have never realized that that is how they behave. And we are seeing a change in behavior pattern. And if you see just the antibiotic prescription, if any doctor who has started, it just continues. And that is no, then there is no discussion. So what I'm trying to say today and some of the take-home messages is that it is important to create that culture of quality and patient safety, but it cannot happen without the top management's involvement. You need to keep engaging with all healthcare workers. There needs to be a culture of reporting and continuous learning. What is lacking in Indian healthcare is there is no innovation and there is no research. And we are all copycats. We copy from another hospital, and we have closed down this phenomena of ours. Quality is definitely a continuous process, and we need to be very, very perseverant. I would really like to thank PolyMed for giving me this opportunity, especially Himanshu ji. It was such a pleasure to meet with you and to know that you are doing so well, and to and thank you for giving me this opportunity to be with you today.
Sir, thank you so much. And I think, first of all, I think, sir, I would also like you to tell a little bit about Amrita Institute, which is coming up in Faridabad. And what is so unique about this institute, and, you know, what things are coming out there, so that, you know, the team knows about, you know, this, you know, this landmark hospital coming in NCR region. So a little bit about this, sir, also.
So this is our old hospital. This is in Kochi. This is in a shape of a very unique architecture, in a shape of a flower with an atrium and six petals. And this is close to 100 acres there. In Faridabad, we are coming up with the 2,200 bed hospital campus. It is 130 acre. We have a medical college, nursing college, allied health science college. But how we are different from any other hospital, the whole scope is very big. So there are 62 operation theaters, there are 574 critical care beds, highest number of operation theaters in the country, highest number of critical care beds in the country. We have an exclusive five-story, 100,000 square feet of research block. Within the research block, it would be both tissue-based and diagnostic-based. And we are also putting on a good manufacturing practices plant within this research block. So we will be working on genomics, proteomics, and cellular therapies. We'll prepare and provide that to the patients who are admitted, and also to the other patients. We have invested another 50,000 square feet on simulation training. So we have a cadaver lab, we have a cold and wet simulators, we have three operation theaters within this simulation training, and we have a cath lab, we have microvascular training center, and this again would be very big. This whole hospital is stretched to close to 40 lakh square feet. So that is again huge. This has a very completely automated lab. So you must have seen a lot of biochemistry and hematology automation, but here we are also going into a digital histopathology, digital cytology, digital hemat, and almost on track molecular biology and microbiology. So there would be less of people who you would see, and they would all be there on the track system. So intent is that can we work on huge volumes and bring in good turnaround time. We also have a huge imaging center with exclusive women's wing, and it's 80,000 square feet of imaging center. And the whole hospital has been divided into exclusive pediatric. So 300 bed exclusive pediatric super specialty hospital. You must have seen a lot of women and child hospital, but we are trying to bring in super specialization within pediatrics and neonatology. And that is would be one of our USP. The intent is, can we bring in clinical excellence? Can we bring in academic excellence? Can we groom, mentor people well? And can we bring in research excellence? Can we get people excited to ask questions and not just do transactional work of seeing patients one-to-one and collecting money, or maybe do charity? But can they have more questions in their mind? Can they innovate? Can they look for new solutions? And that is how we are trying to be different. Thank you again for giving this opportunity to explain this model.
Sir, I just wanted to understand, and you said, you know, the focus is on pediatrics and neonatology. And do we see that in future? Because I think in India, very few hospitals are dedicated in this area, especially for pediatrics and neonatology. And I also don't see any Indian medical device company focusing this area and making products specifically in this area. And knowing that we are a country of high population, our birth rates are very high, and looking at the issues currently in the country, where so much of many people need more medication and more medical help and support. So do you think it's a good area for PolyMed to focus in future, especially in neonatology and pediatric range for medical devices? Because to my knowledge, I don't see any company specifically in India doing these kind of products. And most of the products are imported. And if we continue to rely on imported products, we are going to increase the cost of healthcare delivery to patients in the country. And knowing that you are doing such a great noble cause for the country by building such a big hospital, all money is coming to only charitable organizations or support by contribution by people. So do you think it would be a good idea to get into this area of pediatrics and neonatology?
Sure, because our again intent is that can we super specialize in every bit of pediatrics. So we are getting into very big in pediatric cardiology, pediatric cardiovascular thoracic.
Right.
We are getting into pediatric neurology, pediatric neurosciences, pediatric nephrology, endocrinology, and then have procedure based work. But then the lab, the imaging, the genetics, the research needs to support this pediatric. So there are it's an exclusive 300 bed only for pediatric super speciality. And there is a close to 4 lakh square feet for women and pediatric and neonatology. So this area is niche, I think.
Right.
Would be great for PolyMed to also explore what best can be done.
Right. No, I think that is what I wanted to know, because there are very few people in the country who are specialized in this area. And today, most of the critical products used in neonatology or pediatric care are imported. So
right.
I think as a team, we would work in this area and seek your guidance and support to improve our range in this area. And I think it gives some kind of a direction to us today that where our focus should be going forward. Sir, I'd like to thank you very much for your time. And Dr. Vikram, also thank you so much. I think today it was a great learning how hospitals are managed, what kind of quality parameters are being taken care of, patient safety, cost reduction, better care. So, and I think from our side, the top management is fully committed to be part of this learning process, because we want to be part of the same team. We want to learn together so that we can come with new ideas, new products, new technologies, and improve affordability in the country. Our major objective has been, as a company, is to improve affordability. Can we make more devices at a cheaper cost and good quality, and support the healthcare system in the country, which is so dependent today on AIDS grants? And Amrita is a very big example of a charitable institution where is running on zero profit today. So, it becomes very difficult if the costs are so high today for medical devices or products. So, sir, we will continue to seek your guidance and help in this direction. And whatever we can do together, it will be a privilege and honor to be associated by an institute like Amrita, sir. Thank you so much, sir.